back in the man cave again with my good friend Zolt. And we're going to do some talking, and I'm going to show you as well a couple of things that I do with rigs, etc., and hooks. But the first thing we're going to talk about is like natural hooks. You know, I know a lot of people now, they're getting back to their river fishing. They go into venues where you've got to use, or you don't have to, but they use barbed hooks, because obviously we all know when you're catching roaching skimmers on big lakes, rivers and canals, you always use a barbed hook, and they're really important. And some of my method feeder fishing as well. If I'm allowed, if I go to, I'm going to a place called Shearwater over the winter in the league match, and I'm using a barbed hook for that as well, because you're allowed. So your long range method feeder fishing and long range normal feeder fishing for bream and carp, which I'll run you through that. But let's start off with the hooks that I use when I go to the natural venues like rivers, canals, and obviously natural lakes. Now, there's quite a variation, and some of it is pre-tied, and I love the pre-tied, as you well know. I mean, it saves me a lot of time in here when it's freezing cold, especially. I don't want to be in here. I want to be, what, you know, tucked up, watching the telly, or out fishing. So let's run you through the patterns that I use and what, obviously, Preston actually produce. And it's quite a limited sort of, you know, there's not loads and loads of patterns, and we've done that for a reason, is to stop confusion. And we've decided last year or the year before, we're going to do a lovely selection of hooks, which is going to cover you guys and my fishing for probably sort of 99% of what we do. So let's start off with the N20 or the N10. Let's start off with the N10 and we'll work up as we go along. Now that hook there, I've got the size 12 out. They obviously come in different sizes, from 20s what up to size 12, that an N10. And I might be actually a 22. So it's tiny. So this is a fantastic hook. They're all what they call black nickel. So what they're doing, they're a nickel hook, which makes them extremely strong, but they're coated like dark. So it's obviously, they're not going to be bright. If you had a nickel hook, it'd be bright silver. And to, for me personally, I used to use them hooks many, many years ago, but I always wanted like a sort of a dark hook. And that's what we've done with these. Now, I've got the size 12 out because that is my go-to hook when I go to places like Tamar. I tried different hooks when I went to, when I started fishing Tamar. This is feeder fishing as well as pole fishing. Honestly, it's a long, it's quite a long shank hook. And I just found them so good. And I always did. I'll tell you a story that happened to me. I used to fish a venue called Chard Reservoir years ago, and I went through loads and loads of hooks. This was like 20 years ago, and I always used to lose an odd fish, and I used to use, you know, quite sort of wide gape hooks. And then I used a hook very, very similar to an N10, and I remember catching something like 52 pound of skimmers, and these skimmers were all like between 8 and 10 ounces and 12 ounces. It was amazing fishing back then. And I lost like one fish all day. And from that day, a long shank hook like that always comes out when I'm feeder fishing, especially when I'm catching lots and lots of fish. One, they're really, really easy to get out because you've got a long shank. They're really easy to get your fingernails or your fingers on the hook to get it out. And there's just something about it, whether you're roach fishing or skimmer fishing, they're surprisingly strong as well. You can go through, you know, 014 Aki Power, I tie these on. You know, sort of meter long hook lengths, and I just chop them down throughout the day. But if you're looking for a hook, you know, your canal fishing, when you're catching better stamp fish, definitely have a look at the N10, the natural hooks. They also come pre-tied, which is them. So they come on the mag sticks, and they're all tied to Aki Power, which is one of my favorite lines for basically natural hook fishing. It's a great line. It's easy to tie. So if you want to time your own hooks, it's really simple because it's really grippy, and the knot strength is mega. And like I said, you can buy them pre-tied like that. That's how you get them in the shop. Obviously, you go through your different sizes, your different lines. You know, we've sat down and gone through what line to suit each hook, etc., etc. But the ones I tie for somewhere like Tamar, I tie them on the Revolution. These are obviously just, you know, you can actually buy some of the hook lengths, which I'll show you in a minute, on these Revolution hook length things. But you can see on there, Aki Power 014, 3 foot long, which is a meter, N10, size 12. That's my go-to hook when I was going to Tamar. But I obviously tied them because I wanted them a bit longer. The ones you can buy pre-tied at the moment are all on 6-inch hook lengths like that. So that's the N10. So let's move up then to the N20. And they're all just numbered to make things a little bit simpler. Let me see, there's an N20. An N20, very, very similar wire to the N10. So it's really, really strong for the wire diameter. That's one thing with all these natural hooks. They are super strong because they are black nickel hooks. They're super strong. This is slightly different. This is a wider gape hook. And I know some of you guys out there love the wider gape hook. That is a fantastic hook, as well as the N10 for like worms, corn, maggots, pinkies. It's just a different shape hook. It's a great hook, I think. It's a great corn hook when you're fishing the feeder because it's like a wide gape. Again, these don't come pre-tied on the 6-inch because this, to me, is a more of a feeder hook. I would say, you know, you could use them on the pole and the waggler, but when we sat down, we said this is like your go-to feeder hook for a lot of you guys out there. So, and you can actually buy them on pre-tied on the Revolution hook length spools like that. Because that's what we decided to do. We've mixed and matched these hooks, some on the Revolution, some on the 6-inch Magstore system. So there you go. That's like 014, a size 14. And then you've got 013. And then obviously it tells you what hook it is as well. They're actually tied on power line. So the feeder hook lengths are tied on power line and the pole rigs are tied on Aki Power. That's something that we decided to do. You know, when you're feeder fishing, especially the guys in Europe, they do catch a lot of big bream and big fish like that. And we decided to put that on slightly heavier line. So that's the N20. And then we step up to the N30. This is one of those, what I call traditional shape hooks. It's sort of a round bend, a little bit stronger than the N10 and the N20. Again, spooled up on the Revolutions. We don't do these on the 6-inch pre-tied. I mean, whether we do in the future, I'm not sure. But at the moment, you can get these. They're a bit dirty because I've been carrying these around in my hook box and et cetera, et cetera. Because these are obviously the hooks that I carry. 015, size 14. So because it's a stronger hook, we've tied these to stronger hook length lines, like 015 reflow power, super strong. It matches that hook. So stronger hook, stronger hook lengths. So if you just imagine what you can carry here, you carry a small selection and it covers you for an awful lot of your fishing. When I'm on rivers catching bream, I just use them, you know, 015. If it's really hard, I may go down to like an N20, which is 013. Etc. etc. Obviously, the lines fit the size of the. I've not got every single hook length out here because the old table would be full up. So that's the N30, a great all rounder. Especially if you're catching the bigger fish, like if you go on rivers catching bream, you know, bigger roach and fish like that. And even if you're going to somewhere like, you know, a bream venue where you're not catching many fish but they're bigger, that N30 would be the hook that I use. Then moving on then to the beastie hook, if you like, that is called the N50. Now this is a hook, I think it's very underestimated hook actually. It is so strong. I've been doing some barbel fishing recently and I couldn't be bothered to tie any hook lengths. And I've been on the River Wye feeder fishing with a 60 gram feeder. So you imagine that's a lot of weight when you're hooking a barbel or a chub. That's a lot of weight. And I've actually been using the N50 on 017 and a size 12 with just bunches of maggots. And I've not lost a single fish. I've got to go a little bit careful because obviously we know how hard barbel fight. And the river's been low and clear. So, you know, obviously I've had to get away with a 60 gram feeder. But these are super strong. Again, if you're going somewhere where you can use a barbed hook and you're catching big bream, even hooking the odd carp, and you're allowed to use a barbed hook because obviously these are all barbed, try the N50. They are super strong. Again, all the Revolution hook lengths all come in different sizes and different line diameters. So that's the sort of natural hook range that we do. The only two we do at the moment on the six inch is what you're sort of pole fishing, if you like, is the N10 and the N20, because they're the most popular hooks that we think that you guys need to fish on the pole. All the other ones come on the Revolution hook lengths, or you just buy them in the actual little hook things and time yourself. that N40, just looking at that, when I used to do a lot of blubbering fishing, when it is very, very difficult, a 16 or an 18 in that, you know, pinkies, blubberum, what an amazing hook that is. It is absolutely unbelievable. Honestly, I can't even, I've not spoke about the N40 actually. But these actually come, they don't actually come pre-tied, not yet, in the 6-inch order evolution. But if you're looking for a hook for like your canal, your sort of, you know, lower elastics and lower diameters, once you fish across your canal with blubberm and maggots, honestly, that N40 was an amazing hook. There was nothing like it. I'd always go back to it. If I'm going roach fishing and I'm allowed to use barbed hooks, there is only ever one hook for me, and that was the N40. So if you're looking for a blubberm hook, pinkies, punch fishing on canals, I think me and Zolt done a canal feature a while ago, that hook is absolutely incredible, and that's truthful. So if you're looking for a hook, unfortunately, they don't come pre-tied yet. Check out the N40, because it is a fantastic all-rounder for sort of lighter hook lengths, 09, you know, even down to 08 in the smaller sizes, and sort of 4 and 5 elastics. Great hook. But unfortunately, they don't come pre-tied yet. So that's the natural hooks that we do. There's one hook that I've got to talk about, which is the barb, because these are all about barbed hooks. And that KKH, we do KKHB, which is basically barbless, but this is a KKH eyed version. That's the hook that I've been using, and I use it as much as I can. If I'm going hair rigging for bream, for carp, with bandoms, air rig corn, air rig worms, that's my hook of choice. It's a great hook, super strong, because it is like the KKH barbless, but it's just the bar version. Honestly, I can't remember the last. I think over the whole league at Shearwater, and I've caught, luckily, I've been on some fish, admittedly, I've lost two bream on the way back, and that's where you're basically winding it like 90 metres, and I've only lost two bream, and they haven't cost me, so a great hook. I'm going to show you exactly how I tie that as well, because I think a lot of you out there want to tie. These don't come pre-tied, unfortunately, not yet. You never know what's around the corner, oh. And these have got an outturned eye, which I just think is a great hook. It's a design that Preston have been doing for absolute years. If anybody out there knew the old PR36, the KKH and the KKM is like the, you know, the ongoing hooks, if you like, from that. So I'm going to tie that one up for you. Just give you a thing. Let's get him, because I'm going to use him. I'm actually going to Shearwater this week to finish the league off. Let's get some 017. A nice thing about these hooks, you can fish from 017 to 021 power line, and it can take it. The eye's nice and big as well, which is nice and easy to put the line through. Find a pair of scissors. Just cut that nice clean end off. Now, the first thing I want to do is put a band on. Where's my bands? Medium bands, because I'll be putting, like, where I'm going at the moment, I'm going to be using bandoms, probably 8 and 10 mils. Obviously, you could put a rapid stop on there if you're air rigging corn, meat, or even air rigging worms. Or you can even hook a worm on. I've even been to venues where I just stick a great big dendron, because it's a barb, it's not going to come off. So what I do, stick that through. Glasses. I think I've done this on my last. There's no need to laugh, Salt. Just because you've wore glasses for a lot longer than me. Unfortunately, and I absolutely hate it, I am in the second part of my life, and I've got to wear glasses for... Zolt, stop it. See? It's payback. It's payback for him. So anyway, I've put the line through. I've doubled the line over. It's going to be a bit of slack. And then, basically, I do a single figure of 8. So I bend it round, feed that band back through the bottom. Glasses ain't helping much here at the moment. So feed that back through the bottom, which then you end up with that figure of 8 like that. Now, the art of it, or what I do, is leave that knot, don't tighten it up. Get the tag end in your mouth or on by your teeth, and then the line that's going to the spool, and pull it really fast. Like that. And that brings that knot right down tight to the band. And that's how I've always done it. I prefer to do that. I know some people might have that band just sat in a little loop. I just always preferred. I've got my glasses and I can't see nothing now. And then I just cut that tag end off. Just leave like a mil. You don't have to cut it right tight. And then give yourself a bit of line, because these are 4-inch hook lengths that I'm going to be doing for, obviously, method feeder fishing. If you were fishing a big cage or something with it, you'd obviously give them a bit longer, and then put them on your Revolution spools. I had a hook out just a minute ago. What have I done with that? So, what have I done with that hook?
I'm getting your goodie flip power.
Yeah? There he is. Them glasses are working.
I told you.
Oh, no, brilliant. So, what we do then, obviously, I'm holding the hook like that. I've got the eye, that's the outturned eye facing that way. So I go through the back. I know this is sort of standard stuff for a lot of you, but it is interesting for some of you. That's in. Let that hook go down to me band. Like that. And then I feed that band down the shank of the hook. Hold it like that. So that band is just, I would say, probably 2 mil lower than the actual bend of the hook. So the bend of the hook is like that. I'm sat 2 mil out from it. And then hold that with my other fingers like that. So that's set, ready to tie. And then come round, start from the top. And then it's up to you, really. Obviously, the thicker the main, or the thicker the hook length you use, it obviously comes down a lot quicker. I'm going to go down so it just looks about, like, probably like 3/4 of the way down. Something like that. Then grab that, pinch it. This is the hardest bit a lot of you probably struggle with. I actually pinch that like that. So now my hand's free, but it's not letting the knot come undone. And then feed that from the front, so the opposite way as you started, from the front to the back. Give that a little lick. Pull that nice and tight. And that's a perfectly tied air rig on a KKH size 12. And then I just look at that then. I want that line just coming smack off the back of that hook. Give that a bit of a yank like that. So that's bang on. And then you can use an hook length. I've got one of the new hook length boxes there. I can use that as a guide. Some people have a bit of wood on their workbench or something like that with two little pins, and I just use a hook box like that, 4 inches, because that's what I want. And these hook boxes have got the pins sat slightly higher. So if you want to tie your own hook length, you can use that as a jig. So 4 inches. I put the hook in there. Come down to 4 inch. Come around the pin. Grab the two lines together. Bring it off. So that's the length that I want. And then just do your single or double figure of eight. I always do singles. I just find it a lot easier. It's never let me down. Keep the loop at a sensible size. I know some of you might use loop sizers. I just like a sensible size loop because it makes it a lot easier on the bank. Where's my little dibber float that I use? Which is basically, I stick on there, give it a, tighten it up, which tightens the knot up. Cut that little, and give yourself plenty of line as well. I know you waste a little bit of line, but if you're not brilliant at tying hooks, give yourself a bit of line. Obviously, you can stick that in the bin. Like that. And then that is ready to go. 4 inches. And it depends on what hook box you use. I'm starting to use these new Absolute hook boxes, which I absolutely love. And then that fits in there like that, like a guitar string. Absolutely bang on. Ready to go. So that's the easy, you know, that's how easy it is to tie a 4-inch hook length. So yeah, so that's the natural hook range. Obviously, a lot of those hooks are about fishing natural waters like canals and rivers, like I've said. But the one, this is definitely, if you are into your sort of method feeder fishing, or, you know, if you want to air rig worms, meat, corn, like that, on bream waters or carp waters, try that KKH-eyed barb, because it's an absolutely amazing hook. Right, well, we've done the natural hooks. Next thing I'm going to talk about is the natural floats, and obviously the natural float setup, which I know a lot of you get asked, you know, yeah, Des, we love your commercial stuff, but can you talk a bit about your natural fishing? And it's something that I've done for years and years and years. I still love it. I don't do as much as what I used to, but I do try and get out, whether it's, you know, reservoir fishing, or whether I'm fishing rivers and canals. And it's the same principles. When we looked at the hooks, the natural hooks, we wanted to keep it compact. We didn't want loads and loads and loads of hooks because it's confusing. And I think, you know, a lot of the time you don't need that many hooks. You just need the right hooks. And it's the same with the natural floats. We've kept to the right floats, which is going to cover you for all your fishing. Now, I've got a couple of trays there. These have been tied up for quite some time in there. You know, a couple of trays like that, where you've got a different selection of floats. Them floats in there are Powers and Kerrys. They're the sort of floats I use on rivers, you know, Gloucester Canal, anywhere really. Tamar, Porth Reservoir, if I was going back there again. They're the two floats it would probably do me for all the fishing. So let's talk about the range. There's only four floats in the range, so it's nice and compact and simple. I'll start off with that little beautiful thing that's called a shipper. So it's named after me, thankfully, short and stumpy. They are an amazing little float. They're only short. If I hold them like that in my hand, they're probably like, that is a point, like all the range of natural floats we do, they come in all different sizes. You know, these go from 0.25, I think, right up to somewhere like a gram. If you do canal fishing, or if you want to fish shallow for like bleak, fish like that, they are an absolute fantastic float. Going back to the canal sort of video that me and Zolt done last year, you cannot believe how that float sits. I know it's very delicate, it looks, you know, it's tiny, but honestly, when you're fishing little canals, little drains, like I said, pinkish squats, it doesn't really matter what bait you're using. When you've got a nasty toe on the water, a nasty skim, them float sits incredibly well. There's no float out there that doesn't sit like that on a nasty skimming canal. They just sit there. They're very, very sensitive. Obviously, they've got a fiber tip, nickel titanium stem, so it's really strong. It's not going to let you down. That's actually a 0.4. Now, if you look at that, that's a really small short float for a 0.4 float, but there is a reason behind that. They cock immediately and they catch very, very quickly. I don't use them on commercials. I mean, it is all about, for me, that sort of float. You could use them on commercials if you like, but for me, I obviously stick with my normal floats. But that on a canal, you know, any sort of canal, even if you're bagging on a whip, they can make a really good whip float. So that's called the shipper. Then stepping up to that, this is called a, well, obviously it's the pencil float. It's called a Paolo, I think it's called, Zolt. I pronounced that correctly. Again, it depends on what you want to do. Pencil floats, you can even use that on a running water. You can use it on still waters. Lots of people like pencil floats. That, when you strike, there is no sort of, what's the word I'm looking for? There's no resistance. It just comes out of the water very, very quickly. You know, you can't really hold back on that when you're fishing a river. But when you're just letting a bait run, like hemp, lots of people use pencil floats for hemp fishing when they just want it running through and they want to lift the bait like that and let it go back again. That's what them floats are so good at, because there's no resistance and they settle very, very quickly, because like I said, there's no body for it to sort of stop it from going down. Great float, again, canals, drains, even river fishing, that float can be absolutely deadly. Again, various sizes, they go up to, I think, at least a gram. I can't remember exactly what they go up to. I've got my little thing there with all the different floats in it I've got from Preston. A lot of them are my sample floats that I've had. Obviously, I've tied some up. I've got them in there up to a gram. So, you know, fantastic floats, whether you're fishing rivers, canals or drains, and any sort of bait really, punch, squats, pinkies and overground bait and baits like that. And these are probably the most two, you know, the most popular floats that I use, because I don't do so much of the canal fishing that anymore. There's a float there called a Kerry. It's a beautiful float. Obviously, it's a bigger float. It comes in various sizes. All these floats got nickel titanium wire, so they're very, very strong. But that is sort of a teardrop shape float. Great all-rounder. Again, rivers, probably sort of slow moving rivers, a bit like the Bristol Avon when it's like, you know, sort of flat, because it is an awesome float. Very, very sensitive. It's got a very, very nice fin bristle. Like I said, wire stem, beautiful shape. You can even lift and drop these. Bloodworm, pinkies, any sort of bait, really. Bits of chop worm. But these are longer for fishing in deeper venues, such as deeper rivers and canals. Like I said, but lots and lots of different sizes. So great all-rounder. Last but not least is a float called the Power. It's sort of a traditional round-bodied shape float. Great, again, bit like the Kerry. The difference with that float is it's got a thicker bristle. It's not so sensitive. So for fishing rivers where they're actually flowing, that float will hold back. The line actually goes through the eye and then through the body. So you can fish with bigger lines. You know, if you're fishing for bigger fish, you can do, and it's not going to wreck the float. Nickel titanium wire, again, slightly thicker. As these floats go up, especially the Kerry and the Power, as these floats go up in sizes, we've also put the stem thickness up a bit, so you get more stability. That's a size, that's a 1.25. I mean, these are the ones that I've tied up for the rivers. If I go on rivers or go on the Gloucester Canal, things like that, they're my number one choice, especially if it's moving about, if it's windy, where if it's really, really nice conditions and I'm fishing with bloodworm, you know, pinkies, I want it a little bit more sensitive. That's when the Kerry comes in. You can see the two different thicknesses on there. As you can see from that, two variations in the hollows. You know, you can see the difference in thicknesses there. And like I said, the Power is probably the all-rounder, if you like. That's the float that you could probably even use on commercials if you wanted to, if it was a deep commercial especially. But the most important thing, I think, is to show you guys my shotting pattern on a float such as the Kerry and the Power. On those two floats, it depends really. On those little stumpy little floats, which is the Paolo and the Shipper, they're very short, and normally my shotting pattern is quite tight, and because I'll be fishing canals with squats and pinkies, and I bring everything down. So I'll be fishing with like 4-inch hook lengths. If I'm fishing the Kent Avon Canal, for example, probably 4-inch hook lengths in, you know, because I'll be fishing shallow water. And I've even got some of the Shippers tied up with just little tiny stots down, like literally number 12s just strung out. So when you're fishing with squats and pinkies and you're catching little roach on the drop, which some of us do now, you know, it's lovely fishing when you're doing that sort of style of fishing. And you can, they are absolutely mustard, honestly. They're not good around a Shipper, where the pencil float is more of a sort of, I think, lifting, dropping float, even if you're fishing with punch and blubber and baits like that. But let's run you through my shotting pattern for like what I would say the most, you know, the floats we use sort of day in, day out, which is the Power and the Kerry. Now on my little workbench there, I've got some marks. So this is not my commercial setup. This is my sort of go-to natural water venue where I'm fishing in slightly deeper water. Now the measurements on there, if I can find my tape measure, because we all know we like a tape measure when we're doing these garage videos. So that would be the start of my hook length. And then about just over 5 inches is my second dropper. And then from my second dropper to my third dropper, it's 6 inches. And then I've got a small gap then of, just take that down, of 2 inches. Now that's what I call my kicker shot. And that last mark there would be the start of my bulk. So I've got my kicker shot and my two droppers. Obviously, that's my standard go-to shotting pattern for, you know, if I was going to like Tamar and I'm fishing in sort of 8 to 10, 12 foot water. Obviously, you can adjust that, but this is how I normally set them up. So let's make a rig up for you. So I'm going to start off with which is a lovely size, 0.75 float. 0.3 silicone. As the actual floats get bigger, you might have to put 0.5 silicone on, because like I said earlier on, the actual stems we've changed thicker to suit the float. So let's just cut the same as what you would do with any rig. So I just want to show you the shotting pattern really. Now one thing I do use a lot on natural waters is AccuPower. I think it's a fantastic line. I just prefer it when I'm fishing natural waters and deeper waters, such as river. it's just got one of them, it's just so smooth. And I know a lot of you have probably changed to Aki Power from Powerline. It's just personal preference. I started using that. All these rigs that I've tied here are all on Aki Power. I just love it for that style of fishing. I think it's a fantastic smooth line, and it's a great line, like I said, with the natural hook range to tie your hooks on. So let's start off with a nice clean cut. Really important. Glasses on again, which I don't like putting them on, but I got to. Let's get me silicone on. Exactly this. Oh no, first thing, which was done in the last garage setup, is put your float on first. Stick him down there. Two little bits of silicone first off. 0.3 silicone. Get them on as quick as I can, because I think it's quite boring watching someone put a bit of silicone on. Come on. Typical when you want it to go on when you're filming. And then that slightly bigger piece of silicone, which is double the length of them other two, because you want that just hanging over the bottom of the stem. That's them. Get them on. And the same as what I showed you on the previous garage or man cave. Let's move that out of the way. I've got my little screw in the workbench there to stop the spool from coming off and dropping on the line. Get your three bits of silicone together. Hold your float like that. Little bit of fluid. And like I said, I do like my silicone quite tight. A lot of you might think, actually, that 0.3 is a little bit tight on there, but I do prefer it. I just hate silicone coming off when I'm moving me float when I'm fishing. It drives me insane. So let's get those bits on. So that one goes up the same as the sort of commercial side, probably about an inch down from the body. Second one will go in the middle. The nice thing about that nickel titanium wire is you can bend it and it doesn't have a memory. It basically goes back, or it has a memory because it goes back to how it used to be. So the second bit of silicone in the middle like that, and that third bit just hangs over the edge by sort of a couple of mil. So like that. And I can move that nice like that. Now what I'm gonna do is tie a single figure of eight loop. I say if you use a loop tire or a loop sizer, that's entirely up to you. I do them, but I've done so many over the years that I can normally get them within like the size that I want every time. I'm not too fussed about it, as long as they're not too big and not too small. Cut the tag end off. Now on a 0.75, I'm going to start off with number 9 droppers. Like that. So I've got my shot here. So let's get a few of that on that bit of kitchen towel. I also want some number 8s as well, because the bolt's going to be 8s. So I'm going to get 8s and 9s out. So let's get your number 9. So I'm going to put a number 9 on just above the loop. Now I've got a brand new tool here, which is absolutely brilliant. Where is he? Which is me, Preston pliers, shot pliers. You can get that on there like that. As easy as that. Now what I do then, I'm gonna have to turn around a little bit, get me second number 9. So I've got my little jig on there, so I go put me shot on the first mark, second shot, bend that over your finger like that. It's as simple as getting them pliers. They're absolutely brilliant, them pliers, because they're actually spring-loaded like that, which is so important if you use pliers. So that's the first two shot on, the first two droppers. Don't worry about them being totally exact. I do get them really exact, because that's me. But this is yours. I've just dropped the shot on the floor. That's the way it goes. And then, so that's me two droppers. Now, I've got my third mark on there. So bring your shot up. There's a gap in that. Wrap it around your finger again. Get your pliers. Obviously, you do lose a few. Let's get that again. Stick that on. That's him. Just put that up against your marks. Absolutely bang on. And then me fourth number nine, which is the start of me bulk. And that is that 2 inch, basically, roughly 2 inches above that third dropper. Let's get him on. If you need to adjust it, you can just put it up against your marks like that. Look at it. I mean, there's a little bit of a gap there. If I wanted to, I could just bring that down a little bit on that first bit. So there you go. So at the moment, I've got my first shot, my second shot, my third shot, and then what I call that's the kicker shot. So I've got one, two, my kicker shot, and then that will be the start of my bulk. Now, the bulk on a 0.75 is going to be number eights. So try and keep it nice and tidy. Again, use your pliers. If you don't want to bite them on, you do get used to these pliers very, very quickly. Like that. You'd be surprised. You can, you know, get into a little system. I know I'm going to have to probably put like 8 or 9 shot on. You could use an Olivet, but up to a 0.75, I just prefer a shot. When I get to a gram, then I'll change to an Olivet. So they're nice. With a pair of pliers, it's lovely because you can actually get it. You can actually get the whole shot. Oh, get the whole shot. You can move them down. When you bite them on, sometimes you only bite. I see a lot of people, they actually just bite half the gap over. With a pair of pliers like that, you actually bend the whole gap over and it holds it on the line really nicely. So I know it's taking a bit of time, but this is what we do. You know, this is when I go to natural rivers like the Stour, places like that, you've got to put a bit of effort in. But once you've got them tied, it's just nice. I mean, I do come out here sometimes in even though I'm not fishing natural waters, I'll just catch up on a bit of fishing gear. I'll just get it in my mind, and I'll come out and do like 10 floats, or just do a couple of floats every night, you know. And as you'd be surprised, you can get all your kit really nice and done. Like that. A couple more. I'll stick them in the shotting tube and have a look. This is the boring part of fishing, I'm afraid. But I think these garage videos that we do just shows you exactly what we do. So I've got them on, lovely that. That one's actually slid up the line a bit. I've not done him quite right. Then I just come over to my shotting tube. I think we all know that. So that's why you need a nice big shotting tube, because when you're making rigs like that, tell you what. So that there is literally right on the bottom of the bristle. So what I'm going to do is get a tiny little number 11 start. Like that. And if you bend that line over your finger like that, it takes a little bit of time to get used to, but bend it over. Get them pliers. Doesn't matter what, where we're using, starts or shot. Move that down. I think we'll be absolutely, we will be sock on there, I reckon. So bring that down. Absolutely bang on. Bear in mind, that is quite a sensitive float, a Kerry. And you can see that then, that's half bristle now, which I'm going to leave that. And if I need to, I might be, you know, I might have to put a bit of bristle grease on that. So that's that. Let's take them glasses off because they're doing me head in. Now, obviously, I might be using this in 10 foot of water. So what, if you remember what I said last time, that basically is 6 foot. So we're going to go 6, 12, and a little bit for luck. Chomp that off. Do a nice big loop. Like that. Don't worry about the tag end. I always just kick them on the floor and then vacuum them up later. Move that down, or move the float up rather. Sort of 6-7 foot. I'm not really fussed about that. Just come out of shop and get me a new winder tray. Because this is what I'm changing over to, is all the new winders. Obviously got some lovely winders in there. So obviously that's another thing you're going to have to do, is when you get some big natural floats, you're going to have to get some bigger winders. Because it's really important you keep... floats nice and secure. So just bend that over around the back of the loop. And I always try, you could probably put two rigs on that, but when I'm using big rigs, I've got some of them floats in there on like 0.5. when I get the 0.7, I normally try and keep them separately because they do get damaged if you're not careful. So let's put that on quickly. So if you're a bit out, just bring your float down. Always move your float downwards by holding the bottom of the stem. If you're moving it up, come up to the bottom of the float. But don't do it the opposite way around. If I wanted to move that down now, the last thing I would do is try and move it down from here. I'm trying to move that down. I've got the bottom of the stem like that. Move it down so it's sort of sat in the winder a little bit further up. And you can play through a few rigs. So that's how I have it set. Let me just put the rest of the line on and I'll show you. So, I mean, that's taken a few minutes to do. But once you get your little jig set up, start using those pliers. Like that. And that's sat in there now, lovely. So if I want to put that in my drawers, that sits in there. They're not going to get damaged. That's really important that you don't really want that body actually above the winder. If you can, it depends on what you put them in really. Then get a little Sharpie pen, 014. I know it's Aki Power. I always use Aki Power, 0.75, and a Mr. Kerry. Obviously all these floats are named after an angler. Kerry, Power, Shipper. And there you go. So he's on there. Obviously that I can fit into there. It's nice and secure like that. So that's going to be my new sort of, I can just have these in my garage now with the shippers on. I normally just make them up on 014. That gives me a bit of variation if I go bream fish, for example, or if I'm catching roach on a river and all of a sudden I hook a bream and the bream have rocked up, at least fishing 014 instead of 012, I can then put like a 012 hook length on instead of an 010. So you know, obviously that's the variation that I use. Obviously you can make, you can sort of on the shippers and the pencil floats, I'd probably set up on my 012 because I'm really fishing nice and light in sort of 08 hook lengths. But there you go, that's how simple it is. You know, just follow that little rule of thumb with that shotting pattern. I'll just go through that once more with you because I know you're all into measurements. So from the first shot, it's just over 5 inches. From the second shot, it's 6 inches. And that little kicker gap there is 2 inches. Really, really important. Something that I, you know, fishing for England and things like that, we've come up with that little, or I come up with that little system. Everybody's got their own little way of the shotting pattern. But I think, and we've done that kicker shot. When I used to do a lot of fishing on the resis, poor resi, I always used to get the odd tangle because you're shipping out, you've put your bait in, and what you wanted to do was drop your Olivet or your shot, your bolt shot, exactly over where you fed. And you wanted it to go down. You didn't want it to sort of go down like that. you wanted to go down like that, dead straight. And that was really, really important. You used to catch a lot of these little skimmers and stuff. Sometimes if you didn't drop your rig in right, you wouldn't get a bite. It was incredible. And that's something I've learned over many, many years. But I used to get the odd tangle. And when I started doing this kick, I think I actually was fishing like the Worlds or the Europeans. And I think it's probably one of the Italians. And I noticed that he had that, what we call like a kicker shot. And ever since that day, it's made a big difference to actually stopping tangles. So if you go to deep water venues and, you know, anything to do with canals, rivers and reservoirs and things like that, try that shotting pattern. Obviously, you can adjust. I'm only showing you, a simple setup of number 9 droppers, number 8 as bulks. But obviously, if you wanted to vary that, number 10 droppers, you can do. But just follow that shotting pattern. Like I said, the 0.3 silicone, really, really important. You get your silicone right on your floats. Take that advice, and I'm sure it'll do you proud. Anyway, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoy, you know, the man cave filming that we do. It's been absolutely freezing. I've even got me heated jacket on out here because we can't actually have the heating going because it makes too much noise for the filming. But don't forget to like and subscribe to the Preston YouTube channel to keep carrying on getting great little videos like we do now.